Hello and welcome to the podcast. This is Ron's Amazing Stories, where we play tales to take you away from today. Do you like stories?
Oh yeah!
Then you've come to the right place. On the program today, we have so much stuff that even stuff is jealous.
That doesn't make sense.
It will, my British friend. It will. We have shipwrecks in space, UFOs in the mist, and pigs in the trunk.
That is a lot.
There's more. We travel in time, visit a haunted home, and it all begins with this 5-minute mystery.
Another 5-minute mystery.
This 5-minute mystery is being brought to you by the phrase, "The postman always rings twice." Why? Why not? Do you have something against famous books written by James M. Cain?
No way.
I didn't think so. Now, on to our story.
Sometimes, Jed, I wish I'd never taken this job as sheriff.
I know what you mean.
Take today, Memorial Day. Everybody else is sitting around their house taking things easy-like.
Or else out boating or having a picnic.
That's right, enjoying themselves. But us, we're sitting around a stuffy old office.
Yep, waiting for something to happen, like vultures. I could think of a lot pleasanter things I'd rather be...
I'll get it. Probably my wife. Green County Sheriff's Office. Who? Tom Edson's farm. Shot? Tom Edson shot by your wife? We'll be right out.
As you can see, Sheriff, my wife Edith is hysterical. She's in no condition to answer questions.
I didn't kill Dad. I didn't. You know I didn't, Ronald.
Jed.
Yep, Sheriff.
As soon as you finish that sketch and notes on the position of the body, you better call Doc Ferris.
That's a good idea. Edith should be placed under a doctor's care immediately. She's been building up to this collapse for some time.
You must believe me. I didn't kill Dad. I wasn't even in the house.
You weren't in the house?
No. I was in the stables talking to the horses when I heard the shots and ran back to the house.
Edith, darling, you know you were in the room kneeling by your father when I came into the house, weren't you?
Oh, yes, Ronald.
And you had the gun in your hand, didn't you?
Yes. Yes, Ronald, but I didn't kill Dad.
You see, Sheriff?
Looks bad.
Tom Edson never approved of Edith's marriage to me, Sheriff, and because of that, Edith and I had never been in here during the 10 years we've been married. This is our first visit.
I've called the doc, Sheriff. He'll be right out.
Good.
Another thing, Sheriff. I noticed the automatic, the murder weapon, had a peculiar odor about it.
Did?
Yep. Smells something like powder or perfume.
It's Edith's gun. He carried it in her purse. You know how things in a woman's purse always smells like their face powder?
Yeah.
Edith and her father had been arguing all morning. Then when I heard the postman blow his whistle, you know how he blows the little whistle on these country routes when he leaves mail? Well, it was a relief to get out of the house. After I walked all the way out that long lane to the mailbox, there wasn't anything there but a couple of bills. While I was walking back, I heard shots and...
Ronald, how can you stand there and so calmly convict your own wife? Sheriff, I didn't kill my father.
I know you didn't, Edith. Now I know that Ronald is the murderer.
On what clues does the sheriff place his accusation that Ronald is the murderer? Do you know? We'll be back in 1 minute with the solution. In the meantime...
Okay, believe it or not, this one has all the clues you need to solve it. Amazing, but true. There was means, opportunity, and even a motive if you listened carefully. But what did trip up the husband? Did you catch it? Let's go find out.
Now, back to our mystery.
Ronald, maybe mail doesn't mean much to you big city folks. You maybe don't pay much attention to its delivery. But we farmers appreciate our mail and know all about deliveries. You couldn't have heard the mailman's whistle and gone out for the mail, Ronald, because today is Memorial Day, a national holiday, and mail isn't delivered on national holidays. However, holiday or not, I'm going to deliver you to the county jail immediately.
Well, the postman may always ring twice, but he never rings on a national holiday. How about that? A fully functional 5-minute mystery. This truly is a banner day in the world of podcasting. Write it down. Heck, let's make this a national holiday. Way to go, FFM. 5-minute mystery. From time to time, I get emails from listeners like Bradford Tucker asking about the older shows. People have noted that on most services, the list is limited to the last 100. This is because places like Apple Podcast and Stitcher only allow for that many. However, if you go directly to ronsamazingstories.com, you'll find that you have access to about 280 podcasts total. So, where are the even older programs? On the main webpage, you'll see a link to the RAS archives, which contains the first 100 shows from way back in 2011. Thank you for the question, Bradford. Our next question comes from Stephanie Moore from right next door to me in Portland, Oregon. Stephanie wrote, "Ron's Amazing Stories. Thank you for the great shows and always evolving content. I think I live near you and was wondering if there was a way to come watch live show tapings. On the last show, you had a very funny outtake and it sounded like you had fun recording the program. Thank you for what you do, Stephanie." Well, Stephanie, first off, I am pretty close to you. I live across the river in Vancouver, Washington. Unfortunately, coming to the shows live is not really a possibility right now. I record the show in a tiny little studio in the back of the house that barely has enough room for me. However, I have been toying with the idea of doing some live shows at the local library. But I have yet to even approach them with the idea. By the way, I do have fun recording the podcast. It is my favorite part. On a similar note, I received this message on Facebook from our loyal fan in Liverpool. Anthony wrote, "Listening to this week's podcast, I found myself laughing out loud at your outtake segment. Oh, and in response to the letter criticizing your podcast, I didn't find one point that I could agree with, but thought that you handled your response with a lot of grace. For what it's worth, I listen to a lot of podcasts and find yours one of the most varied and interesting out there, and always suggest your show to my fellow Liverpudlians. I do miss the OTR segments, but since have accessed the internet archives on your recommendation to fill the gap. A loyal listener, Anthony Dunn from Liverpool, England." Well, thank you for that, Anthony. I shortened down that outtake quite a bit. It was quite a challenge to read through it. I kind of wonder if Darren did it on purpose. Just a thought. Also, for the record, the OTR isn't really gone, but I do have to be more careful these days about copyrights. Thank you so much for listening to the show and sharing it with your friends. That means the world to me. Did you know that you, the listener, have a direct effect on the show and its listeners? If just 1,000 of you told 2 people about it, well, I'm sure you get it. So please help us to grow by telling someone about the podcast. You can't imagine the effect that that will have. I love doing the podcast, and it can only get better if we increase the fan base. Think about all the great stories out there. Speaking of stories, it's time for your stories.
These are your stories, sent by you, for you.
Our first story this week comes from Garth Cody from Sandpoint, Alaska. Garth is a fisherman on the islands there. He says that his job by nature has a lot of downtime, and because of this, he gets to listen to a lot of podcasts and write stories. Here is a story that he wrote that his grandfather told him. My family has always been in the fishing industry. As many of you know, fishing in Alaska is a dangerous business. I myself have been injured more times than I can even count. But injuries are not the only issues. Exposure, bears, and even whales are of concern. I lost my best friend to a bear mauling just 2 years ago. The days are long and the nights are cold, but in the end, if you do your job well, you're set for the season. Now, not all the stories my grandfather told me were of these things. He once had an encounter with a UFO and swears today that this story is true. He was out crabbing on a large boat in the Bering Sea. The ship had a crew of 15 men. It was self-contained, meaning that when you shipped out, you might not return to shore for a week or more. He was on night watch, and fishing for the day had been completed. His job was to watch the wheel and alert the command crew of any danger to the ship. He was not certified to helm the big ship, but even in the 50s, ships were mostly automated. His job was to watch the sea and the skies for foul weather. A strange fog came in about 2 a.m. At first, he thought to wake the officer on deck, but changed his mind when the fog stayed to the port side of the ship. It just hung there like a giant wall. The sea was calm, and there was a light breeze to the northeast. A violet light began to form in the mist. Over time, the light became brighter and better defined. It was in a distinct pattern of three lights forming a triangular shape. This time, he decided to alert command and reached for the ship's comm mic. That is the last thing he remembers. When he came to his senses, he looked at the time. It was 3:15 a.m. Over an hour had passed. The violet lights were gone, as was the fog. He didn't know what to do. If he reported the incident, they would just say he fell asleep, and that could affect his profits. He decided to note the fog and lights in the ship's log and was relieved at 4 a.m. The next day, his buddy Anok came to him and questioned him about the log entry. It turned out that he had had the same experience the night before, but had decided to keep it to himself. He had also lost an hour of time. I know this story lacks excitement, but when my grandfather tells it, you can feel and hear the fear that he keeps inside from that night. Garth Cody, Sandpoint, Alaska. Well, Garth, I don't know how the listeners will feel, but that story sent chills up and down my back. I'm not sure what I would have done. I can only imagine it in my head. Thank you for sharing it with us, and please thank your grandfather as well. Our second story comes from Patrick Walsh from Florida. Pat wrote, "Hello, Ron. Thank you for your show. We listen each week to find out what are Ron's amazing stories. I had to empty my mom's house to get it ready for a new renter. She had passed away suddenly, and we, the family, had decided to rent the place out. It was very hot and humid outside. A tropical storm was on the way. I checked the closets to make sure they were cleaned out and found that the living room coat closet was ice cold. However, the rest of the house was roasting hot. There was no reason for it, and I couldn't figure it out. It is a ranch-style house, and none of the plumbing ran anywhere near that closet. I was just about to leave the house when I heard the closet door open and then slam shut. I left the house that day at a brisk pace. We took care of this house for 2 years after my mother passed, and I always hated going there by myself. Both my sisters agreed and claimed to have seen some pretty strange things there, too. We had many problems with the renters complaining about this noise or that breaking for no apparent reason. Things got so bad with the renters that we decided to sell the house and wash our hands of it. At this point, I should tell you my parents lived in that home for more than 20 years and never had a single issue. My youngest sister lived there for some time during some of those years and could not remember a single event as well. Patrick Walsh, Florida. Well, Patrick, that is just one of those things. I guess I would ask about your mom and if she could still be in the home, or if there was something there held in check by her presence. Who can say, but that is an amazing story. Thank you, Patrick. And now, this brief message from Gladys Goodies. Have you ever read the back of your dog's treats? If you have, you'll find that many of the ingredients in it you can't pronounce or let alone spell. Worse yet, many of these byproducts, chemicals, and other ingredients can even be harmful to your pet. That's why the good folks at Gladys Goodies created their treats.
I'm Gladys, the dachshund, the face of Gladys Goodies. Are you worried about your pet's health? My parents were too, especially since I developed pancreatitis. They couldn't find any treats I could eat, so they made some. Our natural treats are healthy for all dogs, with and without health issues. We have lots of delicious flavors like chicken, turkey, salmon, sweet potato, beef, and more. With our homemade treats, you won't worry about the contents because they have no chemicals, fillers, or bad ingredients. Go to GladysGoodies.com now to get your fur friend a bag. And pick them up some swag while you're there. You'll be glad you did. Remember, we have the treats and swag to make their tails wag. Again, that's GladysGoodies.com. Again, that's GladysGoodies.com.
Thank you, Gladys Goodies. Sometimes when I'm looking for stories for the show, amazing things happen. The stars line up and a miracle ensues. That happened this week. I love music from the 60s and 70s. Always have. One of my favorite artists from that time is David Bowie, and more importantly, the song Space Oddity. Now, I would love to play that song for you, but copyrights say I can't. However, what I can do is read a few lines from the song. Now, I want to give full credit of these words from Space Oddity, which was written and recorded by David Bowie in 1969. This is Major Tom to ground control. I'm stepping through the door, and I'm floating in a most peculiar way, and the stars look very different today. For here am I sitting in a tin can far above the world. Planet Earth is blue, and there is nothing I can do. Now, why did I read that? Well, I'll tell you after our story. It is called Shipwreck in the Sky and was written by Eando Binder. It comes to us from LibriVox.org and is read by Robert Schwartz.
The flight into space that made pilot Captain Dan Barstow famous. The flight was listed at GHQ as Project Songbird. It was sponsored by the Space Medicine Labs of the U.S. Air Force. And its pilot was Captain Dan Barstow. A hand-picked man, Dan Barstow, chosen for the Air Force's most important project of the year because he and his VX-3 had already broken all previous records set by hordes of V-2s, Navy Aerobees, and anything else that flew the skyways. Dan Barstow, first man to cross the sea of air and sight open unlimited space. Pioneer flight to infinity. He grinned and hummed to himself as he settled down for the long jaunt. Too busy to be either thrilled or scared, he considered the 37 instruments he'd have to read, the twice that many records to keep, and the miles of camera film to run. He had been hand-picked and thoroughly conditioned to take it all without more than 10% increases in his pulse rate. So he worked as matter-of-factly as if he were down in the G's centrifuge of the space medicine labs, where he had been schooled for this trip for months. He kept up a running fire of oral reports, through his helmet radio, down to Rough Rock and his CO. "All roger, sir. Temperature falling fast. But this rubberoid spacesuit keeps me cozy. No chills." "Doc Blaine will be happy to hear that. Weightless sensation's pretty queer, and I feel upside down as much as right side up. But no bad effects. Taking shots of the sun's corona now with color film." "Huh? Oh, yes, sir. It's beautiful, all right, now that you mentioned it. But hell, sir, who's got the time for aesthetics now? Oops, that was a close one. 10th meteor whizzing past. Makes me think of flak back on those Berlin bombing runs." Dan couldn't help wincing when the meteors peppered down past. The flak of space. Below, he could see the meteors flare up brightly as they hit the atmosphere. Most of those near his position were small, none bigger than a baseball, and Dan took comfort in the fact that his rocket was small too in the immensity around him. A direct hit would be sheer bad luck. But the good old law of averages were on his side. "Yes, Colonel, this tin can I'm riding is holding together okay," Dan continued to Rough Rock. If he paused even a second in his reports, a top sergeant's yell from the colonel's throat came back for him to keep talking. Every bit of information he could transmit to them was a vital revelation in this U.S. Air Force Alpha exploration of open space beyond Earth's air cushion, with ceiling unlimited to infinity. "Cosmic rays, sir? Sure, the reading shot up double on the Geiger." "Huh? Nah, I don't feel a thing. Like Doc Baird suspected, we invented a lot of old wives' tales in advance, before going into space. I feel fine, so you can put down cosmic ray intensity as a boogeyman." "What's that?" Yeah, sir. The stars shine without winking up here." "What else?" "Space is icky black. No deep purples or queer. More than blacks like some jetted up writers dreamed up. Just plain old, ordinary, dead black." "Earth, sir? Well, it does look dish-shaped from up here. Concave. Sure, I can see all the way to Europe. And say, here's something unexpected. I can see that hurricane off the coast of Florida." "You said it, sir. Once we install permanent space stations up here, it will be easy to spot typhoons, volcano eruptions, tidal waves, earthquakes, what have you, the moment they start up. If you ask me, with a good telescope, you could even spot forest fires the minute they broke out, not to mention a sneak bombing on a target city." "Huh? Sorry, sir, I forgot." Dan broke off and almost retched as his stomach turned a flip-flop to end all flip-flops. The VX-3 had reached the peak of its trajectory at over 1,000 miles altitude and now turned down, lazily at first. He gulped oxygen from the emergency tube at his lips and felt better. "Turning back on schedule, Rough Rock. Peak altitude, 1,037 miles. Everything's fine. No danger. This was all a cinch. Hey, wait. Something not in the books has popped up. Stand by." Dan had felt the rocket swing a bit, strangely, as if gripped by a strong force. Instead of falling directly down towards Earth with a slight pitch, it slanted sideways and spun on its long axis. And then Dan saw what it was. Beneath, intercepting his trajectory, coming around fast over the curvature of the Earth, was a tiny black worldlet, 998 miles above Earth. It might be an enormous meteor, but Dan felt he was right the first time, for it wasn't falling like a meteor, but swinging parallel to Earth's surface on an even keel. He stared at the unexpected discovery, as amazed as if it were a fire-breathing dragon out of a legend. For it was, actually, he realized in a swift, stunned comprehension, more amazing than any legend. Dan kept his voice calm. "Hello, Rough Rock? Listen, nobody expected this. Hold your hat, sir, and sit down. I've discovered a second moon of Earth." "Huh? You heard me right. A second moon. Tie that, will you? Sure, it's tiny. Less than a mile in diameter, I'd say. Dead black in color. Guess that's why telescopes never spotted it. Tiny and black. Blends into the black backdrop of space. It has terrific speed. And that little maverick's gravitational field caught my rocket. Of course, it can't yank me away from Earth's gravity, but the trouble is, yipe, my rocket and that moonlet may be in for a mutual collision course. Dan's trained eyes suddenly saw that grim possibility, barreling around Earth in a narrow orbit with a speed of something near over 12,000 miles an hour, the tiny new moon had, since his ascent, charged directly into his downward freefall. It was a chance in a thousand for a direct hit, except for one added factor. The moonlet exerted enough gravity pull out of its many million ton bulk to warp the rocket into its path, and the thousand to one odds were thus wiped out, becoming even money. Nip and tuck, reported Dan, answering the excited pleadings and questions from Rough Rock. It won't be a head-on crash. I may even miss entirely. Oh, Lord, not with that spire of rock sticking up from it. I'm going to hit that. Dan had heard an atomic bomb blast once, and it sounded like a string of them set off at once as the rocket smashed into the rocky prominence. The rock splintered. The rocket splintered. But Dan was not there to be splintered likewise. He had jammed down a button at the critical moment, and the rocket's emergency escape hatch had ejected him a split second before the violent impact. But Dan blacked out, receiving some of the concussion of the exploding rocket. When his eyes snapped open, he was floating like a feather in open, airless space. His rubberoid spacesuit, living up to its rigid tests, have inflated to its elastic limit. But it held, and within, its automatic units began feeding him oxygen, heat, and radio power. He had a chance now, because he had been ejected cleanly from the rocket, without damage to the protective suit. The stars wheeled dizzily around him. Dan finally saw the reason why. He was not just floating as a free agent in space. He was circling the black moonlet at perhaps 1,000 yards from its pitted surface. "Hello, Rough Rock," he called. "Still alive and kicking, sir. Only now, of all crazy mad things, I'm a moon of this moon. The collision must have knocked me clear out of my down-to-earth orbit. I must have been ejected in the same direction as the moonlet's course. In its gravity field, I don't know. Let an electric brain figure it out sometime. Anyway, now I'm being dragged along in the orbit of the moonlet. How about that? Yes, sir, I'm circling down closer and closer to the moonlet. No, don't worry, sir. It was a weak gravity pull, only a fraction of an Earth G. So I'm drifting down, gently as a cloud. Stand by for my landing on Earth's second moon." The bloated figure in the bulging spacesuit circled the black stony surface several more times, in a narrowing spiral, and finally landed with a soft skidding bump that didn't even jar Dan's teeth. He bounced several more times from a diminishing height of 50-odd feet in grotesque slow motion before he finally came to a stop. He sat still for a moment, adjusting to the fantastic fact of being shipwrecked on an uncharted moonlet, crowding down his pulse rate, which might be over 10% normal now. "Okay, Rough Rock, I hear you. You're telling me, sir. Obviously, I'm marooned here. No rocket to leave with. No way to get back to the terra firma." "What? If you'll pardon my saying so, sir, that's a silly question. Of course I'm scared. Scared green. Sorry about the rocket, sir, losing it for you." "Me, sir? Thank you, sir. But stop apologizing, will you? I know you haven't got any duplicates of the VX-3 ready. No rescue rocket." Dan listened for a moment longer, then broke in roughly. "Oh, for Pete's sake, will you stop crying over me, sir? So I get mine here. I might have gotten it over Berlin, too. Forget it, sir." Dan grinned suddenly. "Look, what have I got to kick about? I'll go out in a flash of glory, at least one headline will put it that way, and I'll get credit in the history books as the man who discovered that Earth has two moons. What more could I ask, really?" Dan blushed at the reply from Rough Rock. "Will you lay off, please, Colonel? How else should a man take it? I'm still scared silly inside. But look, I've really got something to report now. This little runt moon makes tracks around Earth in probably 2 hours minus. If I remember my space nautics right, I'm already looking down over the Grand Canyon, heading west. I'm going to get a pretty terrific bird's-eye view of the whole world in 2 more hours, which is just about how much oxygen I've got left. Lucky, eh?" Dan looked down, watching in fascination the majestic wheeling of the earth below him. His little moonlet did not rotate, or rather, it rotated once for every revolution around the earth, as the moon did, keeping one face earthward, giving him an uninterrupted view. The Sierras on earth hove into clear view, and the broad Pacific. There would follow Hawaii, then Japan, Asia, Europe. No, he saw he was slanting southwest. It would be across the equator, past Australia, perhaps near the South Pole, then up and around over the top of the world, past Greenland, following that great circle around the globe. In any case, his was the speediest trip around the world ever made by man. Before we're out of mutual range, Rough Rock, I'm going to explore this new moon. Me and Columbus, stand by for reports. Dan did his walking in huge leaps that propelled him 50 feet at a step with slight effort due to the extremely feeble gravity of the tiny body. What did he weigh here? Probably no more than an ounce or two. Nothing much to report, Colonel. It's a dead, airless, pipsqueak planetoid. Just a big mile-thick rock, probably. No life, no vegetation, no people, no nothing. Guess you might call me the man in the second moon. And the joke's on me. Well, 1¾ hours of oxygen left by the gauge, or 105 minutes. Sounds like more that way. What's that, sir? Your voice is getting faint. Any last requests from me? Well, one favor, maybe. Pick up my body someday, with another rocket. Yeah, it'll stay preserved up here in this deep freeze of space. That's... Sir, can't hear you much now. Going out of range. Give Betty my fondest. You know the blonde. Well, sir, goodbye now. Dan was glad that Rough Rock's radio voice faded to a whispery nothingness. It wasn't easy to stay casual now. There was nothing more to say, really, and he didn't want to hear any more crying from the CO. The old man had sounded almost hysterical. He wanted just to be alone with his thoughts now, making his final peace with the universe. He checked the gauge with his watch. 90 minutes of oxygen to zero, or, he thought with a grin, eternity minus 90 minutes. He was beginning to have trouble breathing, but it was awesomely grand watching the sweep of earth beneath him, the procession of dots that were islands strung across the Pacific South Seas like a necklace of green beads. He was still within radio range of ships below at sea, yet he didn't contact them. He had nothing to say, like a ghost in the sky. Idly, he kept pitching loose stones, watching their rifle-like speed away from him. Again, a phenomenon of the weak gravity of the moonlet. Actually, he was able to pick up a boulder 10 feet across and heave it away with ease. We who are about to die amuse ourselves, he thought. Then, because a thread of stubborn hope still clung in a corner of his mind, he got an idea. It had lurked just beyond his mental grasp for some time now. Something significant. Abruptly, facing a light, Dan switched on his radio and contacted a ship below, asking them to relay him to Rough Rock with their more powerful transmitter.
Ahoy, Rough Rock! Stop adding up my insurance, Colonel. I'm coming back. No, sir. I haven't gone out of my head, sir. It's so simple it's a laugh, sir. See you in a few hours, sir.
And he did. Dan grinned when they hauled his dripping form from the sea. Aboard the search plane, they cut him out of the spacesuit to which was still attached his emergency twin parachute. But his helmet was gone, ripped loose, for Dan had been breathing fresh earth air during the long parachute descent. They stared at him, as at a dead man come alive.
Impossible to escape, he chuckled, repeating their babble. That's what I thought, too, until I remembered those data tables on gravity and escape velocity and such. How, on the moon, the escape velocity is much less than on Earth. And on that tiny second moon, well, my clue was when I threw a stone into the air and it never came back. Dan gulped hot coffee. I got off the moonlet myself, then. Got up to more than a mile above it, where I was free of its feeble gravity. But I was still in the same orbit circling Earth. I'd have continued revolving as a human satellite forever, of course, but for this emergency gadget hooked to my belt. Dan held up a metal gun with its empty tank and needle nose half burned away. Reaction pistol. Fires hydrazine and oxidizer. Ordinary jet rocket principle. Aiming it towards the stars opposite Earth. Its reactive blast shoved me earthward, thanks to Newton. I needed a speed of about 1/2 mile a second. The powerful little jet gun had only my small mass to shove in free space without gravity or friction. That broke me from freefall, around Earth,
to gravity fall toward Earth. Then I spiral down under gravity pull. I reached lung-filling air density just in time before my oxygen gave out. One more danger was that I began heating up like a meteor due to air friction. I flung out a prayer first, followed by my twin parachutes, designed for extreme initial shock. They held, slowed me to a paratrooper's drift the rest of the way down. Wait, a puzzled pilot objected. Your story doesn't hang together. How did you get off that moonlet? How did you get up there, a mile above it, away from its gravity? There was nobody to throw you like a stone. I threw myself, said Dan. First, I ran as fast as I could, maybe halfway around that moonlet to get a good running start. And then, Dan Barstow's grin then was undoubtedly the biggest grin in history. Well, then, since the feeble gravity couldn't pull me back again, what I really did was to jump clear off that moon.
It's true that story is a bit dated, until you realize it was first published in Fantastic Universe in the March 1954 issue. Now, do you get why I read the lyrics from Space Oddity by David Bowie? After I heard this story, I had to wonder if Major Tom and our hero, Captain Dan Barstow, are one and the same. Or at least, did this story inspire Mr. Bowie? Alas, it did not. According to history, Space Oddity was inspired by Stanley Kubrick's 2001 A Space Odyssey in 1968. During that period, spaceflight was of great interest. Our author is yet another story. Eando Binder is a pen name used by two mid-20th century science fiction authors, Earl Andrew Binder and his brother Otto Binder. The name was derived from their first initials, E and O, Eando. Under the Eando name, the Binders wrote and published science fiction, including stories featuring a heroic robot named Adam Link. By 1939, Otto had taken over all of the writing, leaving Earl to act as agent. The pen name Eando Binder is also credited with over 160 comic book stories. How about that? The year is 1944, and this is A Moment in Time. What you're about to hear are four short sound bites that were broadcast over a four-month period. I will introduce each track with a brief description. Take a moment and realize that these are time capsules into time that gives us all a brief look at an era that changed all of humanity. On December 18, 1944, Robert Barr was a reporter that had been through hell. However, the tide was turning, and you can hear that in his voice. Barr is reporting on the Ardennes withdrawal at the Battle of the Bulge.
During the night, the town had been bombed a little, strafed a little, and a siren had wakened us to give warning of paratroop activities. In the morning, there was a rumor that German tanks were just over the hill. Armed patrols went out on the roads. Trees were felled as roadblocks, and thunderbolts and lightnings came low over the town and began wheeling and searching in the woods just east of us. Then the order that everyone hoped would never come came. We had to move out quickly. Somehow the news spread around the little Belgian border town, and the people came out to see the leave-taking. Some of the troops had been there for 3 months. Many had made friends. There was handshaking and many questions. How near were the Germans? Did we think they'd come to their town again? Was it true the German tanks were just over the hill? There were awkward silences. The GIs couldn't answer that question. A truck driver tying the tarpaulin over his loaded truck swore quietly and said, "I never thought this would happen to us."
On December 24, 1944, just 6 days later, a British reporter spoke about comfort just a day before Christmas. He's reporting from Mountbatten, which came to be known as the Forgotten Front.
I have no wish to conceal the seriousness of our task. Much hard fighting and hard marching lies before us. We're a long way yet from the end, and Japan is still strong and aggressive. But we hold the initiative, and the end is sure. Already, more and better ENSA and USO entertainments are on the way. More movie projectors and films will arrive. More and better cigarettes will be available. And last but not least, beer. We were never really the Forgotten Front, though it may have seemed to be so. From now on, I can assure you that we shall be more and more in the thoughts of those at home who realize fully what we are doing and what we are achieving.
We move now to the Pacific. And the date is February 19, 1945. Sergeant Richard Mawson reports during the live battle at Iwo Jima, one of the most famous naval battles in history. It became the iconic end of hostility and marked the beginning of a new age.
The beach that we're going to land on now looks to be very hot from here. We can't see it too well from our position here on this side of the superstructure, but we can see those geysers from bursting mortar shells and artillery shells being tossed up in the air. And also, the land just beyond the water, just inland of the beach itself, seems to be aflame. You can obviously hear this gunfire going on all around us now. We are now inside the screen of warships. There's no more warships between us and the beach. We look out to the stern of us now, and there are hundreds of craft flying out there. But between us and the beach, nothing except a few amphibious craft that are on the beach, disgorge their tanks, and some of these Amtraks and Higgins boats that have already let go their troops. They're still beached in there. As the water's being churned up quite a bit in between us and the beach now with the bursting of these shells. Amtraks are churning back and forth with their loads of Marines. And we can see one. It looks like a tank burning in there on the shore. The fire is burned down low in it. Oh, it's a jeep on the shore that has been hit. Looks like, well, we can't say any more than that. Looking through our glasses now, we're just a couple of hundred yards off the beach. We can see these Amtraks pull up along the beach and dozens of Marines around each one of them. Performing their various duties, trying to free them if possible and get them back out to haul in more Marines. We can see lots of wrecked material over there on the beach. And you can no doubt hear the bursting of these shells, bursting all around us. Looking out to our right now, we can see that Japanese destroyer and those Japanese LSMs. They are really wrecked and corroded. They're all rusty and completely out of use. Even if Tojo had any idea of using them now, he couldn't. Tojo isn't going to get much use out of this item from here on in.
And finally, from March 24th, 1945. This is a report from Richard Dimbleby and is not an accolade for the end of the war. In fact, it should remind us how wild and terrifying war is. This is an account of an event from the war reporter's eyes. I, for one, am glad we have clips like these to make us think twice.
The battle order, the schedule of operations for this great airborne landing in Germany, took up a score of pages of typewritten foolscap, with appendices and charts and timetables and maps. By reading it, you could see how immensely complicated is such an operation. In fact, how great a triumph today has been for Allied planning and execution. The Germans had said that they were ready for airborne landings. They were not, I think, expecting anything quite as powerful and concentrated as this, the biggest airborne force ever carried in one attack. It was British and American, flying parallel within easy sight of each other. The Halifaxes and the Stirlings towing their horses and Hamilcars, the Dakotas each drawing their two wacko gliders. Around us all, giving encouraging flashes in the sun, dashed the little fighters, British and American too. Some from bases in England, some from the forward airfields on the northwestern front. Slowly, I thought contemptuously, the great air fleet moved into Germany. It was so long that the head of the procession was now passing us on its way out. A Stirling shot by with flames coming from its belly. Four white parachutes fled from it and opened and swayed off down to the river bank. The Stirling crashed in a great gout of flame. You thought of the human element then. I looked back to see it through one of our rear windows and caught the eye of Bob Wade, my engineer, crouched over his apparatus. I knew that he'd seen it too. Ahead of us, German flak was staining the sky with its blue-black ink spots. Another tug went down, flaming. No one got out. The tail broke off a glider behind us and went spinning away. The glider paused a second as though surprised, and then reared up and fell, somersaulting. There are no parachutes in gliders. We were almost on the dropping zone now, the patchwork of fields that I'd seen marked out on large-scale photographs, lying below us in the glare of the sun and a dazzling mist. We called up Hamilcar 277 for the last time. You are over your dropping zone now. The Halifax skipped a little as the glider let go. We turned sharply, and a great bunch of flak turned with us just off the starboard wing. 277 wheeled away beautifully, and then I lost sight of her as she joined the hundreds of others, banking silently down like a flight of tired moths, seeking their rest on the ground. And as we turned, I saw simultaneously the smoke of five aircraft blazing like torches in the fields and the woods just below. Some German guns fired, and the Typhoons, who were patrolling on the lookout for just such a thing, swooped and were gone down in a flash to strafe the gunners. Our fighter protection had been first class, but you can't subdue everyone, and there were some of our force who paid the price for hauling their gliders to the right spot at the right time. We, who were lucky, edged out of it and belted back for the Rhine, where Allied guns were setting up grey smoke clouds and Allied craft were crossing the broad river. There were tanks closing up in the winding roads of the West Bank and great convoys of lorries. Below us, the army was on the move into Germany. And back in the flak stains and the mist, its spearhead was now on the ground and fighting by the empty hulks of the gliders, among the black pillars of smoke, the funeral pyres of some of those whose pride it had been to lead the spearhead in.
That is the end of our journey through time. I hope you enjoyed it, or rather, I hope that we all learned something about our past, or we're doomed to repeat it. Thank you for listening. To do it, or at least are trying to work on it. Some of us may never really accomplish it, and for others it is faded away too soon. Tom Williams, well, he's a lucky man. He lives in Berlin, Germany, was raised in Alabama, and sends in these tales from his youth. On Growing Up This Time, we have to make this disclaimer. At no time during the recording of this show were any pigs harmed or mistreated. However, 60 years ago is another story, and the statute of limitation for such crimes, well, you'll get the idea after hearing Growing Up and...
Every time I think I've run out of memories as a child, something new pops into mind. For example, trying to match my father's humor. I found out that when it came to money, humor with him never applied. For example, and I hope animal lovers don't take this too serious, The following truly happened. Living out in the country, as it was known then, and now is a very populated area, my father decided to go across the bay to purchase a small pig to fatten up for food in the forthcoming year. The whole family was loaded into the old Olds 88 and set out for an hour's drive. Just the drive across the causeway, which crossed over Pinto Island and onto Spanish Fort, was a wonderful outing for me and my siblings. My father found the old farmhouse, and dealings went on until they settled for a price, I believe, around $5 for the piglet. We loaded the piglet into the trunk of the car and set out for return home, which was another hour's drive into the dark and foggy night. Now the failed humor sets in. We pulled into the front yard, got out of the car, and approached the trunk with exhaust smoke clearing in the windless night. Boy, the pig ain't gonna be happy, so as soon as I open the trunk, you be prepared to grab him before he gets away. 1, 2, 3, and Dad opened the trunk, and I practically jumped into the back of the car and grabbed the pig. No movement and no sound came from the animal. Dad, I said, either he's asleep or he's dead. Sure enough, the poor animal had suffocated from the exhaust. Stiff as a board, mouth open from gasping for air. My dad said under his breath, now what? $5 down the drain and gas money too. This is where I tried to match my father's humor, which was a mistake. Dad, I said, with a pig's mouth open, why don't we put him on a post and use him as a mailbox beside the road? Then, with a stern voice, he said, get into the house, boy. To this day, I can't remember what happened to that pig. With hard times, we probably ate him anyways. So, never try to match your dad's humor. Sincerely, Tom.
Curse me and color me bad, Tom. I thought that was a funny story. I do feel bad for the pig, though. I thought back over my years and tried to think of a time I tried to match my dad joke for joke. I can't think of a single time. Thank you for the story, Tom. I hope all is well in Germany and that your skies are shining bright. Thank you, my friend. We have an epic list of people to thank this week. Bradford Tucker, Stephanie Moore, Anthony Dunn, Garth Cody, Patrick Walsh, Gladys Goodies, and Tom Williams. This might be the longest list of contributors yet. Thank you to all of you. If you want to follow the podcast or take part in it, head to ronsamazingstories.com. There, you're going to find everything you'll need. Don't forget to leave reviews and feedback about the show. It really does help us to grow. Thank you for listening, and I hope you come again to find out what are Ron's Amazing Stories.
All of the vintage audio used in the podcast is believed to be in the public domain. Ron's Amazing Stories does not own the rights to any of the old-time radio used here. If you hold the rights to any of the shows played, please contact us immediately at ronsamazingstories.com.